Good morning. Previously, we determined the electric potential difference when moving parallel to the direction of a uniform electric field to be equal to the negative of the electric field, capital E, times the distance parallel to the electric field, lowercase d. Today, let's look at determining the electric potential difference when moving at an angle relative to a uniform electric field.
Flippin' physics!
So, let's remove the charged plates from our illustration and retain the uniform electric field. Let's define points lowercase a1 and lowercase b such that we have the same electric potential difference from point a1 to point b as we did before. Negative electric field times distance d. Let's define point lowercase a2 such that it is at a horizontal distance x from point a1, and let's label the distance from point a2 to b lowercase h. And Bobby, please determine the electric potential difference when going from point a2 to point b.
The electric potential difference from point a2 to point b equals, well, we have both the dot product equation and the one with the cosine theta in it. Let's use the one with the cosine theta. Theta is defined as the angle between the direction of the electric field and the direction of the infinitesimally small displacement dr, which is directed from A2 to B.
That angle and the angle in the triangle by point B are alternate interior angles, so they have the same value.
Right. Cool. Cosine of an angle equals the length of the adjacent side over the length of the hypotenuse. Therefore, the cosine of this angle equals length d over length h. The electric fields, distance d, and distance h are all constant values, so they can all be taken out from the integral. The integral from a2 to b with respect to position is just the distance from a2 to b, which is the distance h. H cancels out, and the electric potential difference between point a2 and point b equals the negative of the electric field times distance d.
That is the same as the electric potential difference from point a1 to point b. Why is that?
That is because the electric potential difference from point a2 to point a1 equals zero. The angle between the electric field and the infinitesimal displacement dr, which points from a2 to a1, is 90 degrees, and the cosine of 90 degrees equals zero. In other words, points A1 and A2 have the same electric potential. Points A1 and A2 are on an equipotential surface. In fact, we just showed that every point along the line created by points A1 and A2 have the same electric potential. That makes that an equipotential line. If we are talking about a surface with the same electric potential, it would be an equipotential surface. An equipotential surface or line has the same electric potential at every point on the surface or line. Equipotential surfaces or lines are always perpendicular to the electric field. That means the electric field has no components along an equipotential surface or line. Actually, I'm going to stop saying both surface and line. You get the idea. Equipotential lines are sometimes called isolines. The work required to move a charge equals charge times electric potential difference, and when moving a charge along an equipotential surface, the electric potential difference is zero. Therefore, the work required to move a charge along an equipotential surface is zero. Let's switch our example now to a positive point charge. In a previous lesson, we determined the electric field. It looks like this. Given what we know about equipotential lines, we know the equipotential lines around a positive point charge look like this. Actually, let's make all of those equipotential lines blue because that is what we did last time for the electric field for a positive charge. Notice how all the equipotential lines are perpendicular to the electric field lines. And let's switch to a negative charge in red. Now, I know the electric potential lines for the negative charge look like they are identical to the ones for a positive charge. They are not identical, only very similar. The electric potential lines for the positive charge all have positive values.
However, the electric potential lines for the negative charge all have negative values. So, same shape, but the positive charge has positive equipotential lines, and the negative charge has negative equipotential lines.
Positive equipotential lines around a positive point charge, and negative electric potential lines around a negative point charge. Yeah.
Right. Now let's switch to a simple electric dipole. An electric dipole is a pair of electric charges of equal magnitude but opposite sign, separated by some typically small distance. I probably should have mentioned that last time, but, you know, I can't think of everything.
You do come pretty close, though.
Thanks, Billy. Let's start with just the electric fields caused by each of the singular charges. And let's add the equipotential lines caused by each of the singular charges. And let's transition to the electric field and equipotential lines caused by both charges together. You know, the electric dipole. Actually, let's do that again. Start with just the electric fields caused by each of the singular charges. Add the equipotential lines caused by each of the singular charges. And again, transition to the electric field and equipotential lines caused by the electric dipole. Now, notice the electric potential caused by the electric dipole is calculated simply by summing the values of the electric potential caused by each point charge. This is because electric potential is a scalar value. This means there exists, for an electric dipole, a vertical equipotential line directly between the two equal magnitude charges because the electric potential from both charges adds up to zero along that line. That means all of the equipotential lines in the positive point charge half of the electric field are positive. And all of the equipotential lines in the negative point charge half of the field are negative. Actually, we have yet to discuss the equation for the electric potential caused by a single point charge. So let's get the electric potential and field line map back on the screen around just the singular positive point charge. The equation for the electric potential which surrounds and is caused by a point charge equals the Coulomb constant times the charge, all divided by the distance from the center of the point charge to the location of the electric potential. This equation defines zero potential to be infinitely far away from the point charge, just like the universal gravitational potential energy equation. Bo, using that, could you please determine the electric potential energy of two point charges?
We know electric potential equals electric potential energy divided by charge. Electric potential energy then equals charge times electric potential. Substitute the equation for the electric potential of one point charge, and we get that the electric potential energy of two point charges equals the Coulomb constant times charge 1 times charge 2, all divided by R, the distance between centers of charge of the two charges.
Thank you, Bo. Realize, because electric potential and electric potential energy are scalar values, determining those values for multiple particles uses superposition. You just add all the values together. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.